some jumping jacks because I'm sure you're stiff from plowing against that wind? Why don't you all stand and sing this song with me?
Your vows are covenant unbroken. You made it known through history. Never walk out on me, never walk out on me. I have no reason to doubt you, for you have been, you'll always be.
Your word.
could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end, and you never do. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again, 'cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. I've got one response, I've got just one move. Oh!
Good morning. As we enter into communion time, it is the time where we focus on Jesus as the center of why we gather and how we gather and what he's done for us. And in some ways, I was thinking of this time in a little bit of the rock statues that the children of Israel were supposed to pile together when they crossed the Jordan. So they crossed the Jordan, and Joshua says to the people, I want you to, each of the leaders of the 12 tribes, they're supposed to grab a stone and put a stone on the other side. The purpose of that is so that the kids will ask the parents, what do we do this for? And so part of this, doing this on a regular basis too, is, so why do we do this? What does it mean? Why don't we have the Ten Commandments here? Why a meal? Why is this different? So Luke 19, Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man there was by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was short and could not see over the crowd, so he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up to him and said, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. And all the people saw this and began to mutter, he has gone to be the guest of a sinner. As we gather today around the table, he has gone to be the guest of a sinner. That's how we approach the table. All the same in that kind of space. But that's not the end of the story, and we'll finish it in a moment. We'll just say a prayer of blessing on the table. Lord, I thank you for your wonderful grace and mercy that though we come to this table as sinners, as broken, as incomplete, as making poor choices, you desire to be with us. You did not listen to the call of the Pharisees to ignore the people, to ignore Zacchaeus because he was a sinner, but you instead did the opposite and pursued and went into the space of those who are broken and hurting, for those who have chosen bad things, and yet you've come into their midst. And so today we celebrate this table as broken sinners before you and yet sitting together with you. Thank you. Amen. All the people saw the decision of Jesus to join Zacchaeus at his meal at his home. And they muttered, "He has gone to be the guest of a sinner." But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half my possessions to the poor. And if I've cheated anyone out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount." And Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost." All right, a few announcements this morning. Just a reminder to get your survey in about the service. We're going to be using that as a part of the decision-making process at our congregational meeting, which is happening in 2 weeks on the 29th at 6:30. Next week, we've been putting the book out in segments. Next week, you'll get the whole book as a kind of one unit. On Friday, so just want to let you know that. Dalmeny Day is coming up in 3 weeks. We're going to be meeting at the elementary school park. I don't even know if it has, does it have a name? We were trying to figure that out the other day. I don't think it has a name, official name to it. Is it just Prairie View Park? Anyway, the one by the elementary school. Breakfast at 9:30, worship time at 9:45. We are going to need some help with some food, either doing some cutting up on the Saturday or some making some muffins or purchasing things. If you can help in any way, just to let me know, and I will connect you with the people who need to be talked to about that. Teen Challenge is coming next week. The women's program is coming, and we'll be doing most of the service. And Amber, where are you?
Okay, so, is this on? Yeah, yep. There we go. Who likes free muffins? Hands up. Yeah, okay. Who likes free pizza? Yeah, good, good. I feel like a game show host. This is so exciting. So as you can see behind me, we are planning a spring cleaning day here at the church. And if you come, you can get free muffins and free pizza. And you can also clean. It's a good deal all around. So Saturday, June 11th, starting at 9 o'clock here at the church, we are going to do some sprucing up of our building. We'd like to wash the windows inside and out. If it's raining, we'll probably focus on the inside of the building more, but it will happen rain or shine. Okay, so come on out, bring your family. We'll need kids, we'll need people of all ages to come help. Just as many hands as we can to come and get this church clean after our long winter. So we're gonna wipe down some walls, cupboard doors, clean the kitchen appliances, the fridge and the ovens. We're going to work on cleaning out the shed and organizing some spaces like that. So I'd like a volunteer. If somebody has a truck and a trailer, I'm sure there'll be some things we'll be needing to get rid of, bring it to the dump. So come talk to me. If you are able to come that day, please come talk to me so I know how much food to order. I'll be marking you down. And if you can't come, you're still able to help. I'm going to have a bucket or a box outside in the entrance there. If you have any old rubber gloves to donate or rags to donate, please throw them in there. I know I always have extra things sitting around. So please throw those in there. I'm sure we'll need lots of extra things. But we will be providing the cleaning solutions and things like that. If you come and you do have your own rubber gloves and buckets to bring, that'd be awesome as well. So 9 o'clock to around 2 o'clock, depending on how long it takes us to get through some projects. And my number's up there. You can text or call me or just talk to me here at church. If you have any questions, please let me know. But it'll be a good time.
Thank you, Amber. Any other announcements to make note of this morning? Abe? Kind of figured you might.
Good morning. I figured I'd do it during announcement time. We had the Redberry Run yesterday. I am a little bit sore. I did cheat a little bit, so I'm not as sore. I did get busted. My wife didn't get a picture, but she did put it on Facebook. Yes, I grabbed onto the golf cart up the hill. But I was checking in with how Marianne was doing. It was a two-sided thing. It was good for both of us. And stuff. So yeah, no, it was actually a pretty good day overall. It was a little windier than we would have liked on the return trip. But overall, it was kind of cool and cloudy in the morning, which wasn't bad because there was lots of hills. It was hard work and stuff. But then the afternoon, actually, the sun come out and it got quite warm. And so it was really, really a great time. I think there was over 21 registrations. I know I counted in the picture after everyone kind of finished, and there was 50 people in the picture wearing their run shirt, so there was at least 50 people that had been at camp running, walking, jogging, biking up and down the hills. We went straight east to camp, and just praise God for, you know, just the perfect weather, pretty good conditions. It rained the night before, which is well needed. And then we had a good day for what we wanted and stuff. And so, you know, God's so good and stuff in that. And and then we had the open house in the afternoon, and there was a few families. I'm not exactly sure how many. I know there was at least two that I know of that had never been to camp and stuff. And so that was really cool. And some of them are signing up for camp. And so it was just a neat opportunity to do skills and activities. And I know there was a bunch of laser taggers out there and wall climbers and stuff. And so, yeah, it was really good. It was nice to see just people coming out to camp and being able to enjoy the facility and partake of everything. And then for those that weren't there, just really want to thank you guys for your sponsorship, your support, your prayers. It's really is a blessing and stuff, and it's really felt right across the board and stuff. And in that, we were able to raise over $67,000 yesterday. Oh. It'll go a long ways in helping out with our spring budget and just being able to do the many things that camp does. So thank you.
Awesome. Thanks, Abe. Anybody else this morning? All right. Abe, if you have the strength, would you be able to move that table over to the side?
Good morning. All right, okay, set those down. Those may or not be a little bit heavy. We're going to talk about those in a little bit. Oh, it is good to be here this morning. All right, let's take a look. So this month, we are supposed to be talking about resilience. And for the past 2 weeks down in Sunday school, the kids have been hearing all about stories in the Bible that show us how to keep going after we've been knocked down, which is exactly what resilience is. It is getting back up when something gets you down. You know, the other day I was supposed to go to the city, and then I had to change my plans because of sick kids. And then because my plans changed, I ended up being at home, which was okay, and I thought I'd get a bunch of chores done around the house. But that didn't happen because, you know, sometimes sick kids and phones ringing and other things going on. And so then because of that, I was late to get groceries, so I had to go get groceries. And then I was late for the next thing, and then I just kind of felt behind. And then I forgot something important because of all those things. And by the end of the day, I felt kind of like things had just gone wrong all day. Have you ever had those days where you kind of been knocked down and you feel like nothing's gone right? Doesn't it seem like life does that to us sometimes? One thing after another. It could be small, silly things that go wrong, or it could be bigger things. sometimes life can seem like one big obstacle course. Oh, speaking of obstacle courses, actually, I was thinking, it's been a while since we've had some fun around here, right? So why don't I just grab a few things? Sure. Yep, there you go. Does that mean you're volunteering? Yeah, you think so? Okay, awesome. Well, this is what I'm going to need. I am going to need two teams of three people. And this was my first thought. And okay, so Riley, I'm putting you on the spot here, bud. And you know you have the freedom to say no. But here's the thing. Today is Riley's 13th birthday. Riley, we love you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Riley. Happy birthday to you. Okay, so, Riley, why don't you come on up? And here's the deal. Because I'm making you come up, you get to pick any two other people that you want to be on your team. Just two. And like adults or youth? Yeah, bring her up. All right. Okay. Oh, look at that. We have Team Torrance coming to the front. All right, you guys can stand on this side. All right, now we've got Team Tony over here. Karis, come on up. And Chloe, come on up. I gave my Sunday school leaders a heads up that they might get voluntold this morning, and so I'm so glad they volunteered. That is awesome. All right, this is what we're going to do. Let me just finish setting some of this up right here. Okay, I'm going to put those right there. All right, so this is a little game I like to call When the Going Gets Tough. Now, I think it's going to help us see just how we can bounce back after we go through all the obstacles in life. This might look like a simple obstacle course, even though I haven't even told you what you're doing yet. But don't you worry, because it's not gonna be simple. We're gonna make it a little trickier. So there's three tasks you're gonna have to perform. The first one, you're gonna have to take these cups and stack them up in a pyramid, right? 1, 2, 3. Oh, maybe like that.
Well, you look like you're doing a good job.
I am. I guess you don't have one for the top. So just like that. You should have the same number of cups. Do you want to count yours? Make sure you have the same number of cups. So it's fair. You can take those down. But you can just count them. There we go. And then this one, this is another stacking one. This one, you actually only like have to stack these in a stack, one on top of the other. Simple, right? Okay, last one is this. Last one, your team gets a ping pong ball and you have to bounce it off of the ground or off of something. I mean, you could bounce it off someone's head if you want. And get it in the basket, okay? But before you decide which team member is doing which task, I'm gonna let you know how we're gonna make this more challenging. For the first one, the cups. You aren't just stacking them with both hands. You are stacking them with one hand standing on one foot. Okay? Not too bad. Okay. The second one, you are using one hand, one foot, and you have to carry this backpack on your back. I may have taken some books off the table and put them in here, so it should be a little bit heavy at least. And the third one, one hand, one foot, backpack, blindfold. Oh yeah. And so your team members can retrieve the ball for you so you're not tripping over the steps because I'm not liable for any of that. Okay, have you had a chance to decide which team members are doing which challenge? All right. So here's the deal. The first person, who's doing cups?
Oh, no, I need that first. There.
Yeah, you have to give it to your mother first. And this is yours for when you're ready. Okay. Okay, so before you go, we get to do one thing at a time. So your team has to finish the cups before you do the blocks. You have to finish the blocks before you attempt to do the ping pong in a basket. Are you guys ready? That wasn't confident at all. Are you guys ready? Sure. Okay. First team to win just gets like a big round of applause because that's fun. On your mark. Get set, go. All right, he's violently shaking the cups over here. We've got Chloe going. How are we doing? Okay, not too bad, not too bad. Team Tony has a bit of a, edge on Team Torrens. All right, Karis is starting her blocks. Okay. Here we go. Almost done. Good work. Nice job, Riley. Now we get to start the stacking. You can put your foot down now. Yes, you betcha. All right, she's done. Okay, now we got the ping pong balls. Oh, Team Tony. All right, finish it. You can finish it, yeah. All right, we're going to see Team Torrens wrap this up. Go, Team Torrens. You got this. All right. Yep. Oh, just about. You're yay! Good job. Okay, that was fast. Tony's got skills. Who knew that?
No one.
Oh, man, that was awesome. Thank you guys. You can have a seat. Oh, that was fun. I really enjoyed that. Hey, Tony, actually, do you mind cleaning this up while I wrap up? He always asks me every morning, what can I do to help you this morning? And so I'm just, you know, putting him to work. Just as I'm going to wrap up here, part of me has missed these last 2 weeks of children's features and getting a chance to talk about resilience. And then I realized, though, that we actually have been talking about resilience even without saying that word. 2 weeks ago, I shared about how some of us learned how to share the gospel on the street with random strangers. And then we went out and we did it. And if you've ever tried to do this, it's ridiculously difficult. I don't feel like I'm built to just walk up to people and say, hey, can I chat with you about Jesus? I'm way more comfortable doing this. But I tried it. And the first person kind of just walked away, and then the next person, it kind of felt like, it never really felt like I succeeded that afternoon. It kind of felt like I failed. However, we didn't stop trying. We kept going. So even though we got knocked down, we kept going. And at the end of the day, when we gathered as one big group, we got to hear some really cool success stories. And at the end of the day, there was like, 37 people who accepted Christ. And so as a group, there was lots of success. Even if personally, I didn't get the chance to lead someone to Christ, that's okay. I did get the chance to pray with some people. And some of those people, I prayed for some sickness. And I don't know, did God heal the person that we were praying for? It was someone's father who had COVID, and I was praying for them. And so I might never know that. I might never know how God answered that prayer. But I got back up, and I did it again. And that's resilience. And then last week we talked about Mother's Day, and we purposely talked about how Mother's Day is really a messy type of holiday, because there's not just lots of celebrating of mothers, but there's lots of tough stuff as well. there is loss, there is grieving, there is all the things that we talked about that encompass Mother's Day. And as a mother, man, there's things that knock me down every day that I have to get back up because my kids just don't disappear. I can't just quit. I have literally been that mom that has cried over spilled milk. It happens. But then you get back up and you do it again. Because God has given us that ability to be resilient, to get back up after we've been knocked down. And then yesterday, like Abe talked about a little bit already, the Redberry Run. Man, that's just like the wind was literally trying to push us over. And I really wasn't feeling the run, to be honest. So I got to about the 2K mark, and I stopped, and I was like, I think this is it. I think I'm gonna turn around. I mean, I didn't really feel like I was quitting because I didn't actually make a goal because I didn't want to, because I didn't want to have to meet that goal. But I got to the 2K mark, like, okay, this is okay, I'm gonna turn around. And then here comes Lila running down the road, and she stops for a little bit and we chat, and I go, hey, how you doing? Are you gonna turn around? And nope, I'm going. And I'm like, okay. And I stood there, and she starts going, and I'm like, I can't turn around now. I can't go back the other way when she's going this way. And so I'm like, do you want me to come with you? And come on, Mom, let's go. So because of Lila, I not only went 4 kilometers that day, I went 8 kilometers yesterday. And I was super proud of how she, in that simple moment, was able to teach me how to be resilient. And it wasn't like I actually got knocked down. I made a choice, but she helped me be resilient. And I went a lot farther than I originally was planning. And we got to the end, and we were able to cheer, and it was all happy, and look back. And I'm glad that I made that choice. I'm glad that I had someone come alongside me, even though it was my own daughter, who had a chance to say, let's keep going. And the fun thing is that as tough stuff happens in our life every day, small things and big things, it's a guarantee that we're gonna be knocked down. That's not the fun part. The fun part is that God knows this ahead of time. And he has given us not just stories in the Bible, and there is many stories about resilience and about people who keep going after something terrible has happened to them. But there's a specific verse from Isaiah 40:31 that always helps me remember that God's got this. He's got my back. That doesn't mean I'm not gonna fail. I will fail miserably many times, but God's got this. He stands behind me. He goes before me. He surrounds me with his angel armies. And this is from Isaiah 40, 30, and 31. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. Okay, I did grow weary, but I ran. They will walk and not be faint. God is a good God, and he, in his wisdom, knows what we're going to encounter in life, and he gives us what we need so when we encounter those moments, we can know how to get back up, and we can know that it's possible to get back up. Let's pray. Holy Jesus, I thank you so much for the fun stuff that we get to do here. I thank you for the tough stuff, even though it's hard to be thankful for tough things in our life, especially when we're in the middle of going through them and we can't see a way out and we don't know how you're going to use this for something good. We can trust in your very nature, God, and we can trust in the path that you have put before us. And so whether we're a kid and we go to school, and for some of us kids, just going to school every day is difficult. I was talking to someone the other day, God, and I mean, you overheard this conversation about someone who wasn't good at school at all. And that was tough. And now as an adult, they're doing incredible, God. You know the things that we go through. You know the tough things that come our way. And yet you meet us in those moments and in those spots. And you grow us to be more like you. And so I pray that you help us see those tough things through that light so that we can grow to be more like you, so we can be more confident in who we are as children of the most incredibly high God ever. In your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Now, just as I head down, just a note for parents. We're actually switching things up this morning, and we had a parent supper on Friday, and we got to talk about lots of little things. And one of those things was just a simple: how do we transition to the sermon and to sending our kids downstairs? And so because of that, we've switched things up, and we're going to have worship time right now. And Gwen's going to come up, and I mean, we want kids to come stay during worship, but it's also a time if you want to send your kids down to nursery, and you can do that, and then you can be back up here in time for Tony's sermon.
Hello. Okay, we're good now. While you guys are taking kids down, if you need to, can I have all of the rest of the kids up here? Because I was thinking I want to teach a camp big action verse, because it was just Redberry Run yesterday, and that's fun. And then Tony said it worked really good with what he was talking about today. So I need all the kids up here. Come on, Soren, come on up. Everybody, come on up. And Riley, you have to come up apparently, because it's your birthday and your mom paid me big bucks. You guys have to sit on the stairs, because I don't want them to watch me, everybody on live stream. I want them to see you. And Audrey, I need you, because she knows the verse. Lila, I need you. And Riley, I need you. And the youth, sure, I need you. So you all have to have a chair, and the chair is actually going to be our horse. So sit down. Kids, go right up to the top step, right up to the top, right up to the top, and then some people can sit on this step. Audrey, you come with me over here, kind of sideways this way so you can see me. And then you wave to all your friends at Spruce Manor, and you say, hi, everybody. We did this with them the other day, and it was a blast. Okay, so I'm not going to hold this the whole time, because I can't do the fun actions then. So I need my horse. Just a minute. Audrey comes built with hers. Okay, first everybody's got to stand up. Okay, so stand, except Audrey, you can stay sitting. So this is Jeremiah 29:11. So I'm going to say each part into the mic so that everybody can hear me. And then I'm just going to yell after that so you guys know what's going on. Okay? So Jeremiah 29:11. So to do this, if you guys, you know, I don't hardly remember this from camp, but Tennille does. So you might have seen this version and you might have a different one, but we'll go with this. And if I change it, it's because I forgot. And we're doing it on the fly. So Jeremiah 29:11. We have to get onto our horse and sit down, and put our hands in our pockets, and put our hat firmly on our head, right? I guess you have to do the hat and then this. And then you're going to say Jeremiah 29:11, but you're going to say it like a cowboy. So it's going to be Jeremiah 29:11. You got that? And you guys can all do this too. You got it? You're on your horses. Your hands have to be in your pockets. You don't really ever do that on your horse. You can, but it's not recommended. Okay, ready? Here we go. Ready? Jeremiah 29:11. Now the next part is, for I know the plans I have for you. So here it goes.
For I know the plans I have for you. Got it? So I know this is the plan, like it's a big blueprint, okay? For I know the plans I have for you. Got it? So from the beginning, on your horse, y'all ready? Hands in your pockets, ready? Jeremiah 29:11. Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you.
And then we go, says the Lord, but you have to pretend that you're in a very free, loud church that actually yells out amen in between. Because worship leaders and pastors really like it. When you hear something they say and you agree and you think that God agrees, you can say, praise the Lord! And you put a hand up like this and you wiggle it. Got it? Everybody, praise the Lord! Right? For I know the plans I have for you. Not praise the Lord, says the Lord. Says the Lord! So that would sound kind of weird if you said that after Tony preached, but when he reads the scripture. Okay, from the beginning, hands in your pockets, on your horse, Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Now we're going to go, they're plans for good and not for disaster. So we got to get our thumbs out, like thumbs up. Ready? They're plans for good and not for disaster. Remember that? And you have to put your hands up and yell, right? Okay. Ready? Thumbs up. Or plans for good and not for disaster. Got it? From the beginning. What? Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. They're plans for good and not for disaster. To give you, we're going to walk through that curtain and find a prize. To give you a future and a hope. And then you have to blow the bubble. Right? Hope. That has to make a big noise. And then I want you to end up. And then after the big air bubble, which is hope in absolutely nothing, the world hopes and believes that it can do it if they try hard and if they find the right person to help them and encourage them and everybody makes everything go good. That's the world's hope. But we have hope that is solid. So we're going to go and then end on a rock. Okay? So not this kind of hope, but this kind of hope. We hope, and it's kind of useless, but it's hope in God, who is solid. Got it? So God comes with his power and his presence, and it's amazing. So to give you a future and a hope. Got it? Are we amazing? Okay. From the beginning. Now I'm going to put this mic down because they can all hear you. Ready? Going off.
I appreciate the feedback we were getting from the parents, and just we want to listen and work together, and so just really thankful for that. So we're adjusting things today because of that. Today we're going to look at hope and the essence of hope and the roots of hope. And we begin with a question from Job in Job 6:11. What strength do I have that I should still hope? What prospects that I should be patient? Job essentially is saying, I have nothing left. Why should I go on? Why should I prolong my life? He's reached a place where hope is gone. And when you are there, the temptation to end your life is real. It hasn't been helpful that his wife has told him that he should just curse God and die. But this morning we want to look at hope. What is hope? What's its roots? And we're going to be spending some time in Romans 8 and 15 mostly today. First off, hope is rooted in a promise, which seems contrary to the reality that we're living in. In the Jeremiah 29:11 passage that we went through here, they were living in exile. Jerusalem was in tatters. The temple was broken down. The walls were all broken. There was basically nothing left of their capital city. The best and the brightest of all Israel had been transported to Babylon. So now they were sitting in Israel, in Babylon instead of in Israel. And that's when this promise is given to them. The people were broken. They were hurting. They were not in their homeland. They were exiles. And yet, God gives them a promise and a hope. But they had not been experiencing that in the moment. They were not at home. They were not in the good space. So hope is rooted in something that, in expectation of what is to come, because it's not in my experience in the moment. It requires patience and endurance, resilience, to use Damaris's word earlier today. These two concepts are central to hope, patience and endurance. Patience to wait for what we hope for, and endurance to push through the obstacles which stand in the way of realizing that we hope for. When we look back at Job in chapter 6, he's struggling for hope, and he's lacking both these things. When he says, what strength that I should still hope? He has no strength to endure. What prospects that I should be patient? He really feels he has no reason to be patient and wait. So in Romans 8, Paul is helping us to be patient, and in Romans 15, to endure. So Romans 8, starting in verse 18, if you want to turn there, we're going to spend a little bit of time in this one and then move to Romans 15. So Romans 8, 18. I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing to the glory that will be revealed in us. For creation waits in eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. For creation was subject to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself would be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the freedom and glory of the children of God. We know that the whole of creation has been groaning, as in the pains of childbirth, right to the present time. Not only so, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for the adoption to sonship, the redemption of our bodies. As Paul begins, he realizes and recognizes that life is hard. Our present reality is suffering and difficulty. The Jews and the Israelites are in exile. They're not at home. He's not pretending that life is sweetness and light. Creation is frustrated. Frustrated because things are not as they ought to be. Not only that, they seem to be getting worse. He says that it's in bondage to decay. When you look at it, as soon as something is created, it begins to decay. You buy a new car at a dealership, if you can find one nowadays, because there's none on the lots. But you buy a new car at a dealership, immediately, as soon as you drive off the lot, the car begins to depreciate. the brakes get worn, the sun harms the color. Life tends toward decay. I was at the Remy Art Gallery. My kids bought me, or McKinley bought me a pass for that. And there was one, I really liked the canvas painting with watercolors on them especially. And part of the reason I like it, it's kind of almost has a textured 3D, a little bit of an element to it, but also because it's cracked. Like you go, especially the one I was looking at, the watercolor paint was it was quite old. I think it was about a 70-year-old painting, and there was cracks all over the painting on this canvas painting. Life tends toward decay. Zach and I used to play basketball one-on-one. It took him till grade 11 to beat me, and now 3 or 4 years later, it's not a contest. He's taller, he's increased his skill, and I'm older and slower. And the combination of those things means that life tends toward decay, and it's not even a contest. Yesterday we were playing with some of the night stuff, and he was playing against the coach from Waltheim, and he did his go-go gadget arm thing and blocked his shot. And just going, yeah, Brandon, yeah, I know. That's why we don't play one-on-one anymore. Life tends toward decay. Paul is not arguing this reality, but he's calling for patience because there's a promise of things getting better. Oops. Come on, help me out here. A liberation of bondage to the law of decay. In the passage here, he uses the image of childbirth. So in childbirth, and I'm not a woman, so I wasn't there, and Michelle had C-section, so she didn't go through that. But in childbirth, the woman is going through incredible pain. But as she's going through it, there's the hope of the child that's to come, the new birth that's to come. And that's the image that Paul uses in this, is you're in pain, it's difficult, extreme pain. But there is a hope to come. And he calls us to patience, to push through, to resilience, the same as a mother does in childbirth. Verse 24, for in this hope we were saved. But hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what they already have? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. It is He who searches our hearts, knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. Sitting with people endless times, either on their deathbeds or in the hospital or in times of great sickness, and they're saying to me, I don't know what to pray for. I don't know what to say. And pointing them back to Romans 8 here, that even in our groans, what the Holy Spirit inside us understands our intent, that when we don't have the words to put to it, and He translates our heart, even the words, the groans that we put together that aren't even words, He translates our heart to the Father. So the Father knows exactly what we desire. Patience is possible because the Holy Spirit helps us in this interim period of groaning and suffering. What keeps us going? Verse 28. We know that in all things God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose. For God foreknew, and He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. This suffering can be redeemed. We talked about that last time, how Jesus aggressively went into the spaces of those who were broken to redeem and bring wholeness to their lives. We do not live in a random, purposeless universe, but an ordered and purpose-driven one where God is seeking to change us and conform us into the image of Jesus. In the midst of the difficulty that Paul has referenced, it's hard to see how God can use this. It seems beyond hope and beyond redemption. We talked about that last week. Nothing is beyond Jesus' ability to redeem. This process of transformation is painful and hard at times. Is it possible? Verse 31. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. Knowing all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I'm convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that's in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. I was waiting for the part B on that one, Gwen. Here you go, that's better. Hope requires patience because we've not received the blessed, good, tearless space that he's promised us. We're still living in exile. We're still in Jeremiah 29:11. But in this space of patient waiting, the Holy Spirit is helping us in translating our groans, working to transform us and redeem the stuff that we are going through, because nothing can separate us from his love. But we're also called to endure, to have resilience. So Romans 15, how does this endurance take place? Romans 15:1. We who are strong ought to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Each of us should please our neighbors for their good, to build them up. For even Christ did not please himself, but it is written, the insults of those who insult you have fallen on me. This line about we who are strong ought to bear with the failings of the weak, and I didn't talk to you about this, Dave's not here. Karen, do you have the message on your phone? No, Dave? Okay, shoot. You do? 2 Corinthians 1, 3 to 5, if you could look that up in the message. David brought that up a little while ago, and it's going to fit here in a moment. God has placed us in community to help us endure struggle, to help us endure difficulty. I mentioned a few weeks ago that I'd sent my script to a few others to help me. And as we were walking through this, the role of community in helping us in the struggle with suicide or when we're feeling hopeless, they commented about how important the role of community was in their life in the time of struggle. Do you have it there, Gwen? Do you want to read it? So the big part of, I like the way the message put that, God brings us alongside somebody else who is struggling in the thing that we've been going through. God has called us to community. So this is, when I asked them to talk about the role of community in their life, this is what they wrote me. If I had to sum it up, the support of others in times of darkness got rid of the lie that I was alone and helped me fix my eyes on Jesus. Even at the best of times, we tend to focus on ourselves. And when we are in survival mode, sometimes it feels like all you can do is sit with yourself. I've been so blessed that in the seasons I've felt the darkest, I've had people walk alongside me and offer their presence. I had to be willing to tell them how I was honestly doing. But then being met with love and grace and being checked on made such a huge difference in my life. I had people willing to spend time with me when I was down and not a whole lot of fun. I had people who held me when I cried, who listened without condemnation while I questioned what felt like the foundations of my faith. They looked like Jesus. Without others in our lives to remind us of the truth, we are vulnerable to the lies of the enemy, lies that we are not enough, that we are alone, that we do not deserve to take up space. This is why we are designed for community, to remind each other of the truth. We all have moments where our faith feels weak, like a bruised reed or flickering flame. Everyone needs space to be vulnerable and share what's really going on inside. My experience has been that putting my struggles into words makes those struggles loosen their hold on me, because the shame and loneliness thrive on silence. And then to be met with reminders of grace and truth makes the burden even lighter. Presence and truth, that's how we others help me through. One without the other is most often not enough. I needed people to come alongside me and gently help me refocus my gaze on Jesus. He is the one who saves us by his grace, but it sure is beautiful when those around us can be tangible reminders of his light and love. The community that we're part of is not just the physical one and the relational one that we have around us. The book of Hebrews gives us the Faith Chapter Hall of Fame and a listing of these characters who've gone through difficulty and trouble. At the end of chapter 11 and bridging chapter 12, Hebrews says this: these were all, and the whole listing of people from Hebrews 11, were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised. Since God had planned something better for us, so only together with us would they be made perfect. Therefore, since we're surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, and they are the witnesses here, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. Let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set out before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. The characters in Hebrews 11 are part of our community. They're included in Scripture as an encouragement to us. And not just those listed in chapter 11, but those who died before us. I think of my grandpa Eugene. He was a pastor. Died when I was 3 in a car accident. He's part of the great cloud of witnesses for me. You may have and likely have others that you can think of even now at this moment that are part of the great cloud of witnesses. We're not alone in this drama. Others have gone before us. Job asked the question, what strength do I have that I should still hope? What prospects that I should be patient? He felt that he had no strength left to endure and no reason for him to be patient. What was not helpful in this was that his friends were not like the ones that were described in the reading that I did from the person who helped me out. They were not good community. In the midst of this, Romans 8 tells us that life is hard, but God's not abandoned us and will never leave us. Romans 15 tells us he's placed us in community to give us the strength to go on and help us endure when we can't do it on our own. Therefore, as Romans 15 closes, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Let's pray. I thank you, Lord, that you are with us. Your word is not blind to the difficulties of life. It does not pretend that things should be sweetness and light and no difficulty at all. In fact, you go into that space over and over and over again. And Hebrews 11 is a testimony of those who've gone before us, who faced difficulty and trial, and yet trusted in you in the midst of it. And I thank you for this community that we can be a part of. In your name, amen. As a part of this, we want to go into a sharing time.
love you, Lord, for your goodness never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
As I was listening to that goodness running after us, this aggressive pursuit of us, thinking about how Jesus did that, as we talked about last week, and I thought of the father in the prodigal son story. While he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him and ran to his son, threw his arms around and kissed him. This is the God who pursues us. Have a good week.